Thank you, Ryan. In the 9:15 service, he thought he was going to get away without saying it. He said there was going to be a kissing booth. That is not going to happen next Sunday. So he got a little confused on the dunk tank. So it's going to be a dunk tank. And yes, I have volunteered to get onto that. But I'm just going to tell you right now, if you or your child thinks, oh, well, I missed the target with the baseballs, I'm going to run up and hit it, I'm going to break your arm if you do it, okay? So you have to hit the target with the ball. I won't do that. I won't violently charge the children. All right, if you have your Bible, open it to Ephesians chapter 5. In 99, I had the opportunity to go to Israel, to the Holy Land. And one of the areas that we visited is an area that's known as the Golan Heights. A lot of great, fascinating history that's gone on there. There's some stuff that's interesting in light of some of the things that are happening over there right now. But as you're driving through the Golan Heights, you might see a picture that's similar to this. And so I want to kind of draw your attention to a few things. You will see a lot of buildings like this that are kind of concrete and just abandoned, not really used. And you have plateaus and some rolling hills and fields. And then way in the background over here, you can see a mountain. So I want you to just imagine for a moment that you and your friends are going to set out from where this picture was taken, and you were going to hike to that mountain. So what, I want you to raise your hand, just kind of ask for some input. What are some things that you would need? Some of the kids in the room, what would you need to get to that mountain? Yes. Water, good. Yes. Food, good, in the back. Yes. Shoes, absolutely. You want shoes, for sure. Let's do way in the back. Jalen. Tools, you might need some tools on the way. Yes, ma'am. Maybe a pack that you put on your back, what's that called? A backpack. Isn't that a brilliant name, by the way, right? Okay, let's have one more. Yes, sir, young man right there, yep. Yep. Amazing, first aid kit, that's what I'm talking about. In case you must have hiked with me before. So you set out with your friends, and I want you to imagine you and your friends, so all the kids, think about your circle of friends, all the adults, whoever those friends are. What are you talking about on the way? Think about that for a second. It's a long walk, so you're going to have some time to talk. You're probably going to be throwing out some jokes, right, and maybe some small talk, how's your day, that kind of thing. How would you cross the field? Would you run? And if you would, my question is, why would you do that? You know my hatred of running. There's no good reason to do it, right? Would you skip? Probably not most of you adults, but maybe some of your kids might want to skip across the field. I spent last evening at the UIL marching contest and watched incredible bands march. And so if you and your band were walking across, you might, right? Like bands do. It's amazing. I'm not making fun. It's incredible. If you and your drill team were going, you might, you know, whatever. And that's all the impressions I'm going to do. Okay, so sorry about that. I have to apologize to my wife when I do those things. It's kind of embarrassing. But it embarrasses her worse than me, which is weird. But anyway, so let's talk to the parents in the room. Parents, you get out of the minivan, and you're going to walk with your kids across the field. Okay, so if you have really small kids, you might have to get the stroller out of the back, right? You got to pack some goldfish and other snacks and all the other things that they'll need. And so if you have older kids, you might say, all right, kids, grab your own stuff, grab your own backpack, whatever it is. And so you set out across the field with your family. Now, if it's my family, we're going to get them out of the van and say, hey, we're going to go to that mountain, so get back in the van, we're going to drive. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying. That's what I'm talking about. Anybody else with me on that? Why are we going to walk to that thing? That's ridiculous, you know? Like, we could see all the field, and let's just go to the mountain. And then when we get to the mountain, we're hoping there's a road, because I'm not going to walk up it. I mean, who does ridiculous things like that? But what if right before you entered the field to head out to that mountain, you were to see this sign, which is so common when you're traveling through the Golan Heights? The Golan Heights has been fought over in numerous wars, lots of skirmishes, lots of fights. And in a lot of the places and on the fields where you're driving past in the Golan Heights, you will find signs like this warning you of landmines. So I want you to imagine for a moment, you're about to walk across that field and you see that sign, and everything that we just laughed and talked about changes, doesn't it? If you have your kids there as a parent, you're going to have a talk with them before you ever step foot in that field. And you're going to tell them something like this: I'm going to walk in front of you, and don't put your foot anywhere that my foot doesn't touch. I don't want you to go to the right and to the left, and don't ever run in front of me. Because you're going to go before them, and you're going to be looking at everything on the ground to make sure that you are not stepping on a mine and therefore leading your kids to do the same. Everything would change, wouldn't it? In fact, in that moment, if you saw that sign and you had to walk across to that mountain, what you're carrying in your backpack, forget the stroller, I'm carrying my kids, and who cares what I'm carrying? What matters is you're watching every single step along the way. Everything would change by that one sign. That kind of intensity is exactly what Paul is going to use in this next section of Ephesians chapter 5. We've been studying through the last three chapters of the book of Ephesians, and today we get to Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 15. I'm going to read verses 15 to 21, and as I read them, I want you to listen. There are going to be three statements in those seven verses, and I want you to listen for those three statements, and we're going to go back and kind of unpack them one by one, starting in verse 15. Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time because the days are evil. That's one statement. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. That's statement number two. And then statement number three is in verses 18 through 21. This is all one statement together. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. So let's go back to verse 15. And I want you to underline the first two words of that verse in your Bible or in your mind. The words "look carefully." It's a Greek word. I'm going to teach it to you. All you parents need to learn this word. I'm going to give you some great parenting advice. It's akribos. Say it with me. Akribos. Say it again. Akribos. One more time. Akribos. In the Greek language, this word is a superlative. Now, for you that forgot what English class taught you, a superlative is when you are describing something of the highest quality. For example, we might say, this is good, that's great, that's greater, and that's the greatest. That greatest is the superlative. It's saying that there is nothing that's going to be better than that. And we love it as parents when we're teaching our kids that. Your kids ever get that mixed up, right? They say, I want that the mostest. You're like, no, we don't say mostest, we say most. Or your kids might be watching a game and they said, that's the goodest home run I've ever seen. And you say, no, honey, wait, Altuve's up in the ninth. Got him, got him, got him. That's what I'm talking about. Yes, yes, I love it, absolutely. Yeah, that home run was good, but Altuve, acribos, say it. Right? Acribos, right? It's the superlative. You probably have this friend, a friend like I've had, where you're in a group and someone says, well, what time is it? You pull out your phone, you look at your watch, and you say, it's 11:30, and they say, well, I have 11:31. Oh, well, you know, can you give me the seconds and maybe the nanoseconds? You know, Captain Precise over here, right? But when they are correcting you and giving you the most accurate, most precise time, that is akribos. That's the meaning of that word. Akribos is a word that simply means precisely or exactly. It is the opposite of carelessly and flippantly. So when Paul says to us to look carefully, akribos, he's saying with the most precision and accuracy that you can muster. So let's imagine for a moment you're going down to the shooting range and there's targets down range and the first person pulls out their gun and they shoot 10 bullets. And the first person hits everything within the inner ring outside of the bullseye, but just inside the inner ring. They're a pretty good shot. We might say that that person is accurate. The next person stands to the line and they pull out the gun and they shoot 10 bullets and every one of those bullets hits within the bullseye and there's a very small spread between the bullets. We would say that that person is more precise, right? And then the last person gets up, shoots the first bullet at the target and hits dead center in the bullseye and the next 9 shots go directly through that same hole. We would call them Robby. You know what I'm saying, right? That is acribos. The other ones were good, they were accurate, and they were precise, but that person is the most precise. And let's say that the safety person at the range then gives you an apple and says to you, I want you to go stand in front of that target, and I want you to put that apple on your head. Which of those 3 shooters would you choose? The third one. You're not going to choose the accurate person or the precise person. You're going to choose the acribos, the most precise. And I want you to hear well what Paul is saying in this verse. He's telling us to look carefully at how we live. That word walk is not the physical steps you take. It's the lifestyle that you live. To live your lives with the utmost precision and accuracy. And then listen to what he says in verse 15. Not as the unwise, but as the wise. That word that's translated in the English language, unwise, is a very, I think, friendly translation of the word. The word in the Greek means a fool. Look carefully, akribos, at the way you live, not as a fool, but as the wise. Now, we might think we have a definition of the fool, of a fool, and you might have some adjectives or words to describe that, but let me give you a few scriptures to show you what the Bible says about a fool. Remember in Matthew chapter 7, Jesus gave the parable or the teaching about the men building on 2 foundations, and he said, everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And we know the end of that person. What is it? Destruction. Proverbs 18 and verse 2 says, a fool takes no pleasure in understanding, but only in expressing his opinion. And if you don't get anything else from this message today, I just showed you a verse that perfectly describes American culture in 2023. You elevate opinion over understanding. You can be and say and identify and do whatever you want to do, and if you scream it the loudest, if you post it the most, and you get the most likes, then that means it's true. But the Bible says that's living in the company of fools that are worried about their opinion rather than understanding. The psalmist said in Psalm 53 and verse 1, the fool says in his heart, there is no God. So we learn biblically that the fool, Jesus said, is the one who hears God's word and turns his back on it. The fool is more interested in hearing himself talk and seeing his own post and giving his own opinion rather than listening to the voice of God. The fool is someone who lives their life as if there is no God. And notice that he says, we should not live as fools. But he says in verse 15, but as wise. They are those who acknowledge God and they listen to his voice and they live not according to their opinion, but trying to understand the will of God. But I want you to look up here on the screen. There's a warning in verse 15. And this warning is for every person in this room who's a Christian. And the warning is in the word you. When Paul wrote this letter to the Ephesians, to whom was he writing? He wasn't writing this letter to all the unbelievers at Ephesus. He wasn't writing this letter for those priests who served, you know, at the house of Artemis, at the temple of Artemis. He's not writing to all the pagans and the heathens. He's writing to believers. to saints at Ephesus. And he tells us in chapter 5 and verse 15 that you as believers need to walk and live your life with such precision that you don't live your life as a fool, but as a wise person. So this is not for unbelievers. This is for every person in this room who claims to be a Christian or a follower of Christ. I was having a conversation recently about atheism. And in atheism, when you take this, and by the way, we'll talk a little bit more about this on Family Night on Wednesday. You really should be coming. They started off wonderfully last month. I hope it'll be enriching for your life. But if you're an atheist, if you believe that there is no God, then you have no objective standard to tell someone that what they did is right or wrong. If there's not a moral law giver, God, then there can be no moral law. But because there is a God, we have morality. And we were talking a little bit about that, but it reminded me of what a pastor once said. He said, we as Christians believe that there is a God, and we believe that God's word is true. But many Christians with their lives live as practical atheists. They believe that there's a God, but they live their lives in such a way where God's word means nothing. They live as if there is no God, like God's word is not important, and living a life that is pleasing to him is not important. With every step of our lives, are we truly living out our faith that we believe that God's word is true and his ways are good? In a conversation recently, a friend shared that throughout her life, she has what she calls, I think, James 4:17 moments, which tell us, whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, to him it's what? Sin. And that's for every person who's a believer in Christ. That there are times in our lives when we're faced with decisions and we have to decide, how am I going to live my life in accordance with God's word, or am I going to live my life in sin? If I could give you a picture, kind of a meme of what Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 15 is, it would be the sign that I showed you earlier from the Golan Heights. God is saying to believers, stop living carelessly. Stop living your life flippantly. But look carefully how you walk. And stop living as fools, but live with God's wisdom. And then he says in verse 16, making the best use of your time because the days are evil. If you ever ask me to go on vacation with you, which you should, I'm fun, okay, I'll tell you that. But if you ever get to go to an amusement park with me, and you're traveling with me, you need to know this right up front before you even ask. If we're going to spend money to go to an amusement park, we will be at the amusement park before it opens. Number two, we will stay until the very last roller coaster runs. We'll stay beyond there. Okay, the park is now closed. We will stay to the point where they come on the system and they're like, we'd like to speak to the father of four who looks like Hopper from Stranger Things. Get out. That's how long we're going to stay, right? That's how long we're going to stay, because I have this opinion. If I'm going to shell out $100 to $150 per person, the more rides, you're getting more out of your money, right? And I'm only going to be there that one day. I don't live there. They tore down Astroworld and took a piece of my heart. I mean, we don't have an amusement park here. So when we go, we are going to spend every moment and squeeze every single second out of that day. Making the best use of your time is buying all of it up and redeeming every part of it and not wasting one moment of the time that you've been given. The prayer of Moses in Psalm 90 and verse 12 was, so teach us to number our days so that we may get a heart of wisdom. We make a mistake by counting years. We celebrate birth dates year by year. And before you know it, after celebrating years, you end up being 47 years old and you look back and you have an 18-year-old and you look back at your time and say, man, have I really been using the life that God's been giving me well? The Bible tells us don't count your years, number your days, because you never know when this day may be the last moment. And so Paul says, redeem or make use, squeeze out every good moment of the time that you've been given. I love the contemporary English version's rendering of this verse. They said, these are evil times, so make every minute count. Any high school senior in the room today, raise your hand. Anybody? All right, good. You have 120 days left in your classrooms. That's it. You have 120 days left of instructional time before your time in high school is done, which will be some of the best opportunities that you will have to make an impact for the sake of God's kingdom and the gospel. So are you going to make every day count? Tomorrow when you go to school and it's over, you'll have 119 left. You see, teach us to number our days so that we don't waste one. And Paul says to us that we must redeem the time, make the best use of the time, because the days are evil. James says that our lives are just a vapor that are here for a little time and vanishes away. True story. This morning I left the house at about 6:30, and as I was putting my shoes on, I turned on the TV to get the weather report to, number one, see if it was going to rain today, and number two, to see if it was going to be hot and I was going to be grouchy. And so the answer to one was, no, it's not going to rain. Number two, it is going to be hot today and Robbie's going to be grouchy. So I got that answer. But the meteorologist is before his big board and he says, this morning there's going to be a light fog, but it'll be gone, I think he said, by 9 a.m. And I thought, if that's not a perfect picture of our life, your life is here for a moment and then by 9 a.m. it's gone. And that's why Paul reminds us, make the best use of the time that you've been given, because the days are evil. That phrase in verse 16 could be referring to the persecution under the Romans that was coming for the people of Ephesus. It could have also been referring to the evil days that they lived in, the sensual pagan culture around them. Regardless of what Paul intended, we don't know for certain what he meant by the days are evil. What we do know is this: stop wasting time. Buy up every moment that you've been given. The days are evil, and God has called you to walk and be a force as children of light in those evil days. And then verse 17, therefore, and he goes on to tell them, therefore, in light of this, don't be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. How do we know the will of God? I hear people ask all the time, I just want to know what God's will is. And I'm not going to, this is not an oversimplification. This is not a Sunday school answer. I'm not trying to be cliche. I'm not being condescending. I'm not trying to say anything except what I really believe, and it's simply this: that if you want to know God's opinion, if you want to know God's will for your life, you have to open your Bible and you have to read His word and listen for His voice to speak to you. That's the voice that you must listen to understand what the will of God is. But so many of us are so confused about God's will because we're listening to so many voices. It's the story of a millennial and a Gen Z and boomer walking through the woods. This is a true story. And they found some tracks. And the Gen Z kid said, well, those are moose tracks. And then the millennial said, no, those are deer tracks. And the boomer, young kids, everybody knows those are elk tracks. And then a moment later, they were all hit and killed by a train. A little bit of dark humor. I thought you'd like that. Weren't seeing that, did you? You didn't see that coming. The point is this: if you're trying to discern God's will and you're listening to all these voices except His, all these voices can be wrong. And it doesn't matter how adamant they are. Those are moose tracks. Those are moose tracks. The train's still coming. If you want to know the will of God, then you have to believe that God's word is sufficient to tell you what His will is. 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 16 says that all scripture, the whole of God's word, is breathed out by God and is profitable for doctrine, to teach you your beliefs, for your teaching, for reproof, to reprove you and show you the things that are wrong, for correction, how to help you turn from those ways, and to train you in righteousness. But listen to verse 17. That the man of God may be complete or mature, here's the key, equipped for every good work. Listen, friends, every good work that you need for your marriage is in this book. Every good work that you need to be trained on for your parenting, it's in this book. Every good word for how you should live your life and with fiscal responsibility, it's in this book. Every word that you need to prepare you for good work in navigating the culture with your kids, it's in this book. And you might say, well, Bible doesn't say anything about internet. You're right. The internet didn't exist in the first century when some of these books were written. But every principle that you need as a parent, every principle that you need as a young person who is flooded with temptation after temptation is in this book. The will of God is in His Word. His Word is complete. It was final so that we don't need new revelation. God has revealed everything that you need in this book. The problem is most of us are not understanding God's will because we're not listening for it and we're not reading it. So if you're going to walk carefully, not as a fool, then you have to listen to God's word, which is full of wisdom. And then we get to verses 18 to 21. All one statement together, and I want us to kind of take them verse by verse. Verse 18, notice what he writes. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit. In a culture that is obsessed with wine and alcohol, God's people need to be different. Now, nobody freak out by that statement. Verse 18 is a verse about control. What is going to be in control of your life? Do not be drunk with wine, because that's debauchery. Now, drinking alcohol is not a sin. That's everybody. We're about to unfollow Pastor on social media, unfriend him, right? No, none of that. Drinking alcohol is not a sin, but being drunk is. But what you see in verse 18 is he does a contrast. Don't be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. Let me teach you some theology about the Holy Spirit. When you place your faith in Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit of God comes and indwells the believer. He lives inside of you. He seals you until the day of redemption. So he lives inside of you. You're a child of God, indwelt by God's Holy Spirit. But notice what he says in verse 18. You need to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God. The implication there is that not every child of God is being filled with God's Holy Spirit. To be filled with the Holy Spirit, it's you yielding to the Holy Spirit's control of your life and giving more and more and more of yourself to Him. It means to be replete. It's like taking a cup and you fill it and it keeps going until it gets to the top, and then there's a little arch, whatever that scientific principle is, where it's as full as you can get it. That's the word for being filled with the Spirit. I want to challenge you with this. Be careful what controls you. You can see it in verse 18. Alcohol, if it begins to control you, will lead to drunkenness. And drunkenness will control you and lead to debauchery, which is all kind of evil. In the culture in which they live, wine was flowing freely. They had a god of wine, and they would have festivals. And they would gather together, and some of the historians from Rome would talk about when the festivals would happen, the wine would flow freely, and everyone in the city would be drunk, and they would use this superlative language, this hyperbole, to describe the state of the city, and all kind of evils would come from that. It's about control. Who is controlling your life? Paul says to us, may it be the Spirit of God, because when you are controlled by the flesh, sin follows. But in verse 19 and following, we find out what it looks like when we're controlled by the Spirit. And let's look at those very quickly. In verse 19, he says, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Don't let the worship team convince you that that means the moment you enter the doors, you should say, good morning, brother. I'd like to greet you with a spiritual song. That's not what he's saying. Doesn't mean we need to be walking around like it's Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs all day, right? But when you are controlled by the Holy Spirit, worship flows from your heart. That's the idea. So be careful what controls you. In verse 20, we find that when we are following Christ and controlled by the Spirit, then gratitude follows. Do you see it there? Giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, always and everything. Verse 18, don't be controlled by wine and drunkenness, which leads to sin, but be controlled by the Spirit. And when he controls you, worship flows from your heart. When he controls you, gratitude follows in every area of your life. And then in verse 21, we find that when the Holy Spirit is control, others become more important than yourself. For every couple in the room today, if I could tell you the second most important verse to memorize for your marriage, it's Ephesians 5:21. I believe the first most important one is Matthew 7:24 to 27, which is the wise and foolish man. The wise man listens to Jesus, builds his life on the rock. The foolish man takes the words of Jesus, discards them, and builds his life on the sand. You have a decision about how you want to build your life. Listen to Jesus, follow him, and stand strong. Reject his word and live your life the way you want, and then it falls. That's the first and most important one. The second one, Ephesians 5:21. I have yet to meet a couple who says to me, I cannot stand being married to this person because they always put me first. Can you imagine that statement? If the next person to tell me that, it's going to be the first. It's all built out of Ephesians 5:21. Submitting yourselves one to another. The Spirit of God that lives in you is the same nature and essence as the God the Father and God the Son. And God the Father so loved the world that he gave his Son so that you could have life. You who were dead could be made alive. God the Son gave his life on the cross so that you who were dead in your sin could be made alive and dressed in his righteousness because of his sacrifice for you. That same Spirit, the same nature lives inside of you. And when the Holy Spirit is controlled, guess how you will love? You will love as Christ loves. Guess how you will serve? You will serve as Christ serves. So every husband in this room today, you should be submitting to the needs of your wife. Stop being selfish. And submit to them. Every wife in the room should submit to the needs of your husband. That's what verse 21 says, does it not? Submitting yourselves one to another. And the language here is all in the context of the church. Every member of the Brook Church needs to submit yourself, humble yourself for the good of other people. So when the Holy Spirit of God is in control, worship flows from your heart, gratitude follows, and other people become more important than yourself. So be careful, friends, about what controls you. You can let your flesh and let sin follow, or you can let the Spirit of God control you and worship and gratitude and godly love and submission to flow. If I could confess to you, church, and we'll ask the worship team to come. I think sometimes we can be too careless with the lives that God has blessed us with. So Paul tells us in verse 15, walk carefully, akribos, with the most precision that you can. Let God guide every step of your journey. That picture that I showed you earlier of those fields in the Golan Heights, what you don't know is on the backside of this building, there are bullet holes all over the backside of this building. Some of them from rounds that were very large. This land has been fought over for years. And if you were to miss the sign of the road and start out on this journey, this field is actually probably pretty okay, but this field back here is a huge field of landmines. But if I hadn't told you that story, you might look at that and say, oh, that's kind of an interesting place. Maybe I'd like to go there, right, to see it. I'd love to see that mountain back there, kind of an interesting story. I wonder what the story is behind this building. And those fields are a picture of our lives. And God has given us his word, and God has given us his Spirit, and he says to us through both today, look carefully how you walk. Don't walk as a fool, but walk as a wise person. And make the best use of the time that you've been given. Squeeze every ounce of goodness out of the life that God has given you, because the days are evil. Look around you and see the life that God has called you to live. And don't be controlled by the flesh, which leads to sin, but be filled and controlled by God's Spirit and let your life flow with worship. Let gratitude follow you all the way, all the days of your life and everywhere you go. And let God's love and his abundant grace and mercy live out in your life as you submit to the needs of other people. So friends, be careful today what controls you. So I'll close just by asking you a few questions. And I want you to just really reflect upon you, not for your kids, not for your spouse, but just you. Am I living carelessly, or am I walking carefully in my life? Maybe there's some areas of your life where you're just a little too flippant with it. Are there areas of my life where I'm listening to the advice of fools rather than listening to the voice of God and trying to understand His will? Or maybe another question, am I turning my back on the Word of God and the way that He has called me to live? And do I value my opinion more than I value God's will for my life? And then the last question today is, what's controlling me? Is it my flesh or is it God's Spirit? And maybe if you, like I have, in preparation for this message, and even as I've taught it today, this is one of those where God speaks through His Word and He speaks to me through it, even as I'm preaching. Maybe there's some areas of your life where you'd say, I'm living like a fool here. I'm not walking the way that God has me to walk. Here's your response to that. Repent. Right? Repentance is simply coming into agreement with God that what He says in His Word is true, and then saying, God, I want to line my life up with what You have said is true. That's repentance. It's turning from a self-ruled and reigned life and turning to God and saying, I want to aim my life in the direction that You've called me to. I want to line up with You. May Your Holy Spirit guide every step. That's the response today. So just know this, as you walk out of this room today, you can leave here changed and better than you came in, as I hope to today. As God brings these things to our hearts today, may we pray, Holy Spirit, have complete control of my life. Help me to walk carefully and to make the best use of the days that God has given me. Will you stand with me today with your heads bowed and your eyes closed as I pray over us, and then we'll worship together and respond as God leads. Father, we thank You for Your goodness and Your love and kindness toward us. I pray, Father, that Your word has gone forth from here faithfully and that it would impact our hearts the way that You see fit. Help us to no longer live carelessly, but to truly walk carefully as Your word calls us to today, and to walk as children of light and to make the best use of the time that You've given us. To walk not according to our will, but to Yours, and to redeem the time because the days are evil. So use Your people here as a force for light in this world. May the world see the light of the gospel shining forth in our lives so that it might compel them to come and to see what Jesus Christ is truly about. I pray for Your people who might be in bondage and being controlled by the flesh and by sin. Father, today they would give control to You and Your Holy Spirit, that You would conform us into Your image so that we might be more and more like Jesus as You've called us to be and how You've called us to live. So just work in our hearts. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.